In this video, we're going to get a closer look at half-life. We learned that the time a radioactive isotope takes to decay to half its original amount is called its half-life. If we counted the time it took for 100 grams of a radioactive isotope to decay to 50 grams, that would be the half-life of that particular isotope. So half-life is a time measured in seconds, and it's different for each decaying isotope. The half-life of carbon-14 is 1.8 times 10 to the 11 seconds, about 5,730 years, while carbon-22 has a half-life of only 6.2 milliseconds. Let's get a bit of practice with this idea of half-life. Say we have 1,000 grams of dubnium-262, which has a half-life of 34 seconds. Take a look at this table that shows how much of the dubnium-262 remains, and how much time has passed, and the number of half-lives experienced. Take a minute, press pause, and try filling out the empty boxes in the table. Okay, how did it go? If your table looks like this, great. If not, let's take a look at the solution together. One thing we saw earlier is there was an equation that could help us fill out a table like this. Remember that if we know how long a certain isotope's half-life is and how much total time has passed, we can figure out how many half-lives have happened. The number of half-lives elapsed equals the total time passed divided by the isotope's half-life. We can use this equation to figure out how much of an original isotope remains after some amount of time has passed. If we start with some initial amount of radioactive isotope, call it M initial, the mass that's left over, call it M remaining, at any given time equals the original mass times 1/2 raised to the number of half-lives completed. Let's try using these relationships to help us answer questions about atomic half-life. You have 75 grams of beryllium-14, a radioactive isotope with a half-life of 5 seconds. How many grams of beryllium-14 remain after 4.5 half-lives have elapsed? Our equation involving initial and final mass is a great start point for our solution. We're given the initial mass of the sample and the number of half-lives it experiences. We're solving for the mass remaining. Let's plug in the initial mass, 75 grams, and the number of half-lives, 4.5. When we plug our given numbers into the equation, we see the mass of 75 grams, beryllium-14 left over after 4.5 half-lives, is 3.3 grams. Let's try another question about radioactive isotope half-life. As part of a radioactive chemical identification project, you are given a 200 milligram sample of an unknown element. After 14 days, the sample has decreased to 7.5 milligrams. Along with the sample, you are provided a chart showing radioactive isotope decay rates and are told the sample is made of one of the elements listed. What isotope is the sample made of? To answer this question, we'll need to figure out what is the half-life of the unknown sample. Let's start with our relationship between the starting and ending sample mass. The sample mass remaining equals the mass at the start times 1/2 raised to the number of half-lives passed. We want to solve for the number of half-lives. We can rearrange this equation to isolate 1/2 to the number of half-lives on one side by dividing by M initial. Since the number of half-lives is the exponent, we'll need to use a special math function called the logarithm to find it. Mathematically, logarithms and exponents go together. If I take the logarithm, or log, of both sides by the property of the logarithm, the right side becomes equal to the number of half-lives times the log of 1/2. Now I'll divide both sides of the equation by the log of 1/2, which leaves us with this equation. The number of half-lives equals the log of the mass remaining, divided by the initial mass, all divided by the log of 1/2. We plug in the final mass of 7.5 milligrams and the initial mass of 200 milligrams, all divided by the log of 1/2. Then we use a calculator to compute the final answer and find that the number of half-lives elapsed is equal to 4.73. The next thing we want to know is how long each one of these 4.73 half-lives is. To figure that out, we can use our equation relating time and half-lives passed. The number of half-lives equals the time passed divided by the time for each half-life. We multiply both sides of the equation by the time of each half-life, T sub HL, and divide both sides by the number of half-lives passed, number HL. We find that each half-life is equal to the time passed divided by the number of half-lives. When we plug in our numbers, we find that the time passed, which is 14 days, divided by the number of half-lives, which is 4.73, gives us a total time for the half-life of 2.96 days. That's about 2.6 times 10 to the fifth seconds. Now we know how long our half-life of our unknown sample is. So what isotope is it? Looking at the given table of isotopes, we see a match between the half-life we calculated and fermium-253. Based on its half-life, the mystery sample is made of the radioactive isotope fermium-253. These radiation events that change an atom's identity are called transmutations. Basically, these nuclear reactions transform one element into another. In order for the identity of an atom to change, the number of protons must change. Here are two transmutation examples. In the first example, radium-226 turns into radon-222, plus an alpha particle. During this transmutation, the atomic number decreases by 2, and the mass number decreases by 4. We know radon is formed because it is element number 86 on the periodic table. In the second example, a transmutation occurs involving beta minus radiation. Here, a neutron changes into a proton and emits an electron. Even though the mass number doesn't change, the atomic number increases by 1. In this example, when a beta particle is released, carbon-14 becomes nitrogen-14. That's a closer look at half-life. For more physics in motion, go to our homepage, where the entire series is available to you.